Our next speaker, Matt Eagleton's from Cleveland Clinic. As you know, he runs a very large investigational device trial at Cleveland Clinic. He's going to really talk to us about how you select healthy aorta and how today we really look at aortas compared to how we looked at it 5 or 10 or maybe even 2 years ago. So, Matt.
I was a little nervous following Jason that this ended up going to be a debate, but I don't think I'm debating Jason here so much. I think I'm agreeing with a lot of what he may say, and I think my approach to this is going to be a bit different than what he's expecting. Maybe. So Mark asked me to talk about selecting healthy aorta for endovascular repair, and this applies to all endovascular repair, whether we're talking about treating an arch aneurysm or treating an infrarenal aneurysm. Well, most of my talk is actually going to be focusing on some of our data from infrarenal aneurysms. These are my disclosures. So what is a healthy aorta? Honestly, I have no idea what a healthy aorta is. I don't think I've ever seen one. So is there any aorta, especially in a patient with an aneurysm, is there any aorta that's healthy? And the answer to that is probably not. There's no healthy aorta there. They have a systemic disease. So given this is the real question, what is healthy enough? What's healthy enough for endovascular repair? What's healthy enough for open repair? And for me, I sort of define this as healthy enough is provide a long-term durable repair. I don't want to have to go back and do something complex later on that's going to make my life miserable and make the patient's life miserable. And for me, that's what a long-term durable repair is. And so how do we determine that? Well, we're kind of limited right now to how we determine that. We assess all this information through what we can measure on, and predominantly it's CT-based imaging, although we use MRI and sometimes IVUS. And we can measure diameter and length and any associated pathology that goes along with it. And these are fairly finite parameters that we can assess off of a CT scan. But what we can't determine, though, is the histologic architecture of the aorta. So if you take an aneurysm like this, we clearly know that some aspects of this aorta are probably have their elastic lamina intact, and some of them are completely destroyed. What we don't know is where the transition point is in that aorta between these two, and we can't tell that based off of the imaging we currently have. Well, you can say, well, maybe we can sample these aortas and find some sort of molecular architecture that may let us know what's a healthy aorta and what's not a healthy aorta. That becomes even more complex. One, it's hard to biopsy these aortas before we treat them. But second, if we look at just the molecular architecture of these aortas, we know that just the thoracic aortic aneurysm has a completely different molecular profile than an abdominal aortic aneurysm. And it gets more complex with that if we even take just the thoracic aortic aneurysms and we compare the posterior aspect of that aorta to the anterior aspect of the aorta and do molecular profiling on them, they're completely different. And so being able to look at the molecular profiles, the molecular architecture in aorta, doesn't really help us so much. So we're back, again, just looking at some simple dimensional things we can measure on a CT scan and then applying these to the IFUs, which people have stuck to those IFUs. They try to show us what outcomes in the ideal setting can be. One of the problems with this is those IFUs have been changing over time as well. We're down to treating IFUs approved for 7-millimeter necks and significant angulations up to 90 degrees. So in that, then we have to put what's called being a doctor into this and make some sort of educated judgment about what becomes a good healthy aorta that I can provide a durable repair with. And certainly if we look at it and look at the morphology of the infrarenal neck, that certainly can affect our repair, and that's a judgment we have to make. We also have to look at the amount of thrombus, angulation, length, and diameter, and these all are a riskier aorta to treat, perhaps. And if we throw multiples over there, we get the hostile neck. I love that in the literature, the hostile neck. And that makes it an even a riskier aorta to treat, and perhaps we'll have poorer outcomes long term. Certainly, with improvement in technology and improvement in imaging, we can have technical success in these difficult aneurysms to treat. Neck angulation used to be a concern. We've got grafts now that are approved for greater than 90 degree angles, and we certainly can treat these. If we look at outcomes related to those, this is just from Eurostar, a little bit old, from 2007. We see a little bit increased rate of type 1 endoleaks, but what we don't see are any changes in mortality or aneurysm-related mortality. I'll put in here quotes, long-term follow-up. But if we start to look at what are we really following up, it's 20 months mean follow-up. Is that long enough? If we look at Abu Rama's paper here, again, increased neck angulation, sure, there are increased type 1 endoleaks, but we saw no effect on reintervention rate and no effect on survival. But again, follow-up, his Kaplan-Meier curves end at 36 months. So you know at 36 months he doesn't have a lot of patients out there. And in fact, if you go back and look at the life table analysis, he doesn't. So the real analysis is somewhere between 12 and probably 18 months when we have a meatier group of patients to look at. What about neck length? Well, certainly in evolution, animals have gone from having short necks up to having long necks. I haven't found an example where it's gone the other direction, except in a vascular intervention where we've changed this. We want to go to shorter and shorter necks. But again, we look at outcomes. We're doing all right. And we take short necks. They may have a little bit of increased systemic complications perioperatively, and they may have a little bit higher death rate perioperatively with those with shorter necks. But if we look at, again, quote unquote, long-term outcomes, we see no difference in AAA-related death or conversion to open surgery. But again, 16 months is the mean follow-up. Newer technology allows us to technically address these issues. And we've got, I know the 3-year data from Europe isn't, I don't think it's been published yet, but we've got the 1-year data from the US trial that shows really we do a super job at 1 year in these. But again, the outcomes are only to 1 year and not long enough to determine durability. So what's the key to determining durability? What's the key to determining a healthy aorta? It's time. And was our judgment about that aorta correct? Because it's our judgment of the aorta determines whether it's healthy or not. We don't have any other way. So how's our judgment? And you know, Jason went over the Schanzer paper, so I won't belabor it, but we don't have a lot of data analyzing this, especially in patients with riskier aortic necks or those outside of the IFU. We heard about Schanzer's paper, so I won't belabor this, but again, he had a five-year post-EVAR rate of sac enlargement. They found a 41% with some independent predictors of sac enlargement, such as a compromised aortic neck or a compromised distal seal zone. Again, this is one of the first papers, though, that looks at this type of data out to 5 years. Why do we have such poor outcomes? Well, maybe it's poor judgment. Maybe it's inadequate imaging to identify healthy aorta. Or maybe it's our underestimating the role of disease progression in these situations, and sort of a combination of all of the other two leading to this third one. We do know that if we look at all aortas over time, they continue to expand, they continue to get larger. And why would that change just because we sew a graft to it or just put an endovascular graft in it? If we look temporal changes in quote-unquote healthy necks in people that underwent open repair or endovascular repair, and this was just published in the JVS in 2012, we found that 20% in those patients that underwent an infrarenal open repair and 22% in those that underwent an EVAR within an IFU had a 2 millimeter increase in their neck diameter over their follow-up period. And here, we're still at low follow-up periods, only about 3 years. So big deal. So they grew 2 millimeters. What's the big deal? Well, it is a big deal if you look at 11% of those open repairs who had 2 millimeter increase in side required a reintervention, and 30%, a third of these required a reintervention for those in the EVAR group. If we look at temporal changes in a hostile neck, and this is from our own group, patients that we knew had a hostile neck, we put an EVAR in, they ended up getting a Palmas stent to seal off the type 1 endoleak we identified. If we look at their outcomes, and this is a mean follow-up of 48 months, a third of the patients had a greater than 10% increase in neck diameter in the suprarenal location, in the infrarenal location, and two-thirds of them continue to have a greater than 10% increase in size 15 millimeters below the renal arteries. So these aneurysms, these aortas continue to degenerate. Here's an example of one of those slow progressive dilations, 4 years period of change in time. It went from 25 millimeters to 28 millimeters, and then we have a nicely floating Palmas stent in the middle of a stent graft. In fact, if we look at, and this is probably the only time I'm going to bring up our IDE, one of the only times I'll bring up our IDE study in this, if we looked at our branched endografting program where we can potentially choose the most ideal proximal and distal landing seal zones within the aorta, and despite this, we have approximately 2% of our patients treated in our research study that have developed a late type 1 endoleak due to continued expansion of the proximal aorta. In all but one of these patients, this occurred more than 7 years after their initial implantation. These are high-risk patients that we honestly didn't think were going to even live this long, but they are. So the mechanism of failure after endo, there are multiple things that can contribute to this, but I think the one that's most underrated, though, is aortic failure and progression of the disease. Can we predict this long-term failure? Can we figure out who these people are that we need to focus more carefully on? I think it's poorly understood right now who these patients are, who will fail, when will they fail, and why do they fail, or how do they fail? We tried to address this within our own site, and we took, of about 1,100 patients in our IDE studies, we took 200, a little over 200 of those that we were referred who had had prior open repair, and they were followed out a long period of time. We excluded patients who had stage procedures or aneurysms that weren't near where their open repair was, and we looked at those who had aneurysms develop adjacent to their open repair, so progression of disease at that location. And of those, we had about 104 that we could actually get detailed information about their prior surgeries on it and detailed imaging information. If we look at the demographics that are associated with these people that ultimately fail, I'll summarize it. It occurred in younger patients that were younger at the time of their initial implantation, those patients that had a family history, those that were initially treated for a dissection, and interestingly, those that had diffuse atherosclerotic disease. The characteristics of those who presented with long-term failure, their mean age at their second repair was 72 years old. That means they were getting their aneurysms treated initially in their 60s. The time between repair, obviously 10 years. Mean aneurysm diameter at their second repair was 72 millimeters. So they're getting found late. So that disease progression is actually happening earlier than 10 years. We just weren't recognizing it because these were open repairs and we didn't follow them routinely with imaging. 10% of them, and just to go along with that, 10% of them presented with symptomatic or ruptured aneurysms. If we look at those patients that presented a bit more quickly, so who's failing a bit more quickly, still long-term, but who's failing quickly, this is older patients that had extensive aneurysms and had other aneurysms throughout their arterial system. So if we look at age as a factor, certainly younger patients are more vulnerable to late failure, and that's probably because their life expectancy is greater than the durability of the repair. Older patients have late failure occur, probably because we give them more limited repair, sparing borderline aortic segments to decrease operative risk. The lessons learned, we know that at least now for us in our late failure patients, younger patients, those with family history, dissections, significant atherosclerotic disease, and a factor I didn't list earlier was chronic renal insufficiency, we give these people lifetime follow-up because at some point they are likely going to have progression of their disease and potential failure of the repair that we did. For those that have fast progressing disease, this is our older patients with extensive aneurysms, we follow them up a little bit more closely than we might otherwise. We don't write them off and say, they were old, they're going to die. And due to the late failure risk, any aortic repair we do now, we should be optimized in the perspective of any future intervention. What can I do now so that if this fails, I have an easier time later on fixing it if I need to? So does long-term outcomes matter in patients with aneurysmal disease? I'd say absolutely yes, it does. And I think our data prior supports that. And so does some population analysis. Currently, our total population is aging. The number of patients that are old is getting greater. And if we couple this with improved survival after AAA repair, which has been happening over the past couple of decades, and this is in particular happening in those patients that are older than 80 years, we have this, the risk of failure is significantly increasing. Should this change how we view our aneurysm repairs? It should. Aneurysm repairs, in my opinion, shouldn't be thought of as a curative event, but more of a palliative intervention. Open surgical repair, it may fail later than EVAR, but ultimately, in many patients, it will fail. EVAR will fail, especially in non-ideal anatomy that portends ongoing disease. This becomes an increasing concern in light of the aging population and improved survival after aneurysm repair. And can we identify specific patients at increased risk, identify portions of the aorta that are at increased risk, and provide an alternate treatment option to them, whether that's snorkeling, chimneys, fenestrated stent graft, branched endografts? We have to take all that into consideration. I think our remaining questions are, is failure really due to device-related failure? It's probably not. Sometimes, yes, but probably not. Many times, it's probably due to disease progression and our poor judgment in assessing the degree that disease progression plays in these patients' lives. If we're going to treat a compromised neck and aneurysms with standard endovascular approaches, we should assess the risk for future degeneration and develop a surgical strategy that will allow easier treatment when and if it fails. And we should consider extending the proximal landing zone to quote-unquote healthier aorta, or at least a portion of the aorta we can treat later. What do we need for the future to make all this easier for us? We need to not underestimate disease progression in patients with aneurysmal disease. We need to not underestimate patient survival after we fix their aneurysm. And we need to develop a better understanding of aneurysmal pathobiology. Why is that important? I think that's a part of our profession that we've ignored in the past. We need to develop adjuncts to assist our current judgment. Whether this is molecular imaging that helps us refine risk prediction and stratification by incorporating biologic information into imaging, the use of biomarkers to help us define earlier when patients are beginning to fail and their aortas are beginning to degenerate, whether it's the use of concomitant pharmacologic treatment to help stabilize at-risk portions of the aorta in addition to open or endovascular surgery, and genomic analysis to help us better estimate at-risk patients. With these improvements, we can better assess patient survival probability, we can better assess aortic failure probability, put these together, and then we can choose a repair method and extent that best balances durability and survival. And I think what this will ultimately do is provide us with better judgment. Thank you.